Well, fam, we have some progress here with the old odd. I was telling you guys yesterday how it had a no crank, no start issue. It still has that issue, but we have a remedy temporarily to solve that issue, and I'll show you what's going on. Check the battery, tons of voltage, check the cables, they're snug, everything's good. Check the starter, tapped with a hammer while I had my wife touching the key. Nothing. So, what I did was I got on YouTube, handy dandy YouTube, 1A Auto had a video talking about how to diagnose a bad starter. I thought, oh, this could be kind of cool. But the part of it that I got away from the video was he was talking about the neutral safety switch. And he was saying how sometimes if you have a bad neutral safety switch, it's not actually a starter, you can have your truck in park and try to start it, which it started this time. But what he said was, if it does that, if it's in park and it won't start, which mine wouldn't until I did this, he said sometimes you can take it down into neutral, apply the brake, then try to start it, and if it's a bad neutral safety switch, it won't start in park, but it might start in neutral just fine with the brake applied, which it did. And then what you could actually do is take it to reverse or neutral and then put it back up into park, and sometimes that kind of sets the linkage where it should be again. Sometimes it makes just enough adjustment to where the switch is engaged again to where you can start it in park just fine. Good and bad news. I mean, the good news is it's nothing like a starter. It's nothing like, you know, a bad computer like some people were saying. It's not like anything crucial. And it's actually just something simple like a neutral safety switch, which is actually not that big of a deal. And actually, it's not even necessarily the switch, because when I use this linkage, it's got a little bit of play in it in park even. It's got a little bit of wiggle room. And then when you put it down into reverse, it's got a little wiggle room. And even down into neutral, it's got some play in it too. And it doesn't really firm up until you get down into drive, and then it locks into drive just fine and just right where it's supposed to be. But the linkage just could be a little bit worn out and it could just need a really small adjustment, and the switch could be totally fine. So if you're having a no crank, no start issue on your 01 1500, I don't know what all years this would apply to, but for the most part, probably like any of the 90s 1500 Dodges up into the 2000s even, if you're not getting a click, you're not even getting a click like from your starter, not even a click, no click, your battery's good, making good voltage, you're not getting anything, put it in neutral, press the brake in, and start the truck. The reason you keep your brake pressed in is A, for safety, but B, just in case your linkage is out of alignment and it's not actually in neutral, it's in reverse or drive, your truck doesn't go rolling. Just a little tip, just in case you guys are also dealing with the same problem. You guys have been asking to see a cold start on the flat nasty. So let's get you guys a cold start. So now we didn't start the flat nasty for absolutely no reason. We're actually moving it over here because we're gonna be grinding off some stuff on the underside of the truck. We've got the airbags right here, right? So we got the airbags installed. However, they have just a lot of extra bolt length. And what I'm gonna do is actually cut the bolt length that's dangling off there about in half. And I'm gonna cut them right about here, actually a little more than half, right about here on all of them, just so there's not so much extra bolt hanging down there, just because it's unnecessary. I believe this is what my dad did with Nasty Reds as well, because it just came with a lot of extra bolt that you didn't really need. And for the most part, it's just, you know, kind of ugly when you're looking under the truck and you see all that extra bolt length, especially since with a flatbed, you can actually see all the extra bolt. We're gonna take the old grinder here and we're gonna get to trimming those down and let you know how that goes, but it should be a pretty simple process. Should just cut them and then that's it. Just don't cut too high. Because once the nuts are already threaded on there, if for some reason you ever have to take them off, you know, if the nut's already threaded on there, you should still be able to back that nut off. You might have to get another one if it chews up the threads, if there's a rough edge where you grind the bolt off, but you should still be able to reuse that totally fine. But you just want to make sure that you know, if you're gonna trim the bolts, just don't trim them until you've already got them situated and where they need to be, so you don't mess up your threads. Otherwise, you're not gonna be threading the nuts onto there. But if you have to back them off after you cut them, that's not very hard to do. I did also buy some new shocks for the truck because I'm pretty sure when he took off the factory blocks off the rear axle, I'm pretty sure he got smaller shocks that fit the right height of it being dropped. Like, he got like reverse level shocks because these ones are like maxed out, and so the rear end's a little bit bouncy now. I'm actually gonna be swapping them out with some Bilsteins, and I think you guys are gonna like that ride quality a lot more than stretched out shocks that are just too short, because it'd probably be fine under a little bit of a load with the airbag still, but it's just a little bit bouncy and I just don't like it. Much better. Got that extra length off all of the airbag bolts, trimmed off. Only have about a half inch on each of them remaining. It's not really something that makes like the biggest difference. It's not like, oh wow, that was really necessary, you had to do that to be able to use the truck properly. But it is something that when you're checking the truck out, you're looking around it, you just don't want to see that. You know, you don't just want to see a bunch of unnecessary bolt length hanging off under there. Just not a good look, but looks a lot better now. Now this next segment of the video, we're gonna film sitting in this beautiful, flat nasty, new headliner, new custom made leather interior. This is literally handmade leather interior. This isn't like some order online and slap it on type crap. This is a few thousand dollar leather interior job on this truck. Beautiful, high quality stuff. I'm actually gonna sit in this thing and do a Q&A with you guys and go over some of your top questions you left under my recent post on Instagram. But first, we're gonna take this lovely towel, put it on this beautiful leather interior. That way I don't get any dirt on your seats. So let's get to this segment in the video. I'm gonna go over just a few questions that I got here under my Instagram post, just because we get some questions. Sometimes I just don't have time to answer all the questions like in the comments or that I randomly get in my DMs. My DMs especially, I get probably more messages in my DMs, questions, than I do like under posts, like under videos or anything else. So I just said, hey, if you want your top questions answered, I'll give you guys a few hours to comment them down here, and then we're just gonna go through some of them and try to get some answers. What happened to the Prosperity Driven Apparel car giveaway brand? Did you just not have enough interest in the clothing to keep it going? Project_second_gen. So with Prosperity Driven Apparel, that company, I got in over my head a little bit, and I'm gonna be completely honest with you on that. So I thought, oh, it'd be so cool to start a completely separate company and run two at the same time. Not just two. I was running Prosperity Driven Apparel, lnpgear.com, and Reagan had been currently running her giveaway brand, which was Diesel Babe. DieselBabeGear.com, I think, is what her website was. We were running three companies at once, and they were all e-commerce, they were all online, and for a little while it was going really great. Where it became to be a hassle was marketing both. And we were running it just me and Reagan. We were doing everything ourselves, everything. So everything from ads to marketing to, you know, customer email support and everything, we were doing all of it. So it was one of those things where, you know, I'm focusing on the truck thing as much as I can, focus, focus, focus. And then I'm like, crap, I need to make sure I'm marketing for the car giveaway, because if I don't market for that, we're not gonna sell stuff. So I'm like trying to market for that, and then the sales would go really good. And then I'm like, ah, I gotta focus on the trucks. So then we focus on the truck thing, and then the car sales go down and the truck sales go up. And so it was like this back and forth thing where I'm like, crap, I like, I either need to hire more people to get in my corner, or I just need to push that off for now, close that up, and just come back to it if it makes more sense. We have more people on board to work that brand, just because, you know, you've seen other companies do the same thing. I could list several companies that did the same thing. They thought, let's start two different ones. And then it comes to find out that's actually not the best way to do it. What would actually make more sense would be like when we were giving away the 6-speed manual regular cab
fourth gen with custom leather interior and all that, and we were giving away that truck, and at the same time we were doing the Hellcat. What I should have just done was give away the truck in the Hellcat under lnpgear.com only, and just ran them as one giveaway, where if you entered, you entered to win both of them from one website, you know, so I could really just focus on that one brand, that one goal. And that would just be, A, it makes more sense, and B, you know, I probably would have had even more interest in the car, because guys also would have had the option to pick a truck. So that probably would have made a lot more sense, just because then it wasn't like, oh, well, I gotta enter on this site, and then if I wanna enter for the car, I gotta go to that site and enter on that site. Just should have been thought out a little bit better. So for now, I just was like, you know, we're not gonna run Prosperity Driven Apparel separately right now. So for now, we're just gonna not do the car giveaways, keep doing the truck thing for a little while. Maybe if we do that again, we'll just run them like together as one giveaway, so I can focus on the one thing and not try to split my attention up, because that can cost you when you do stuff like that. Will we ever see a swap project on the channel? More specifically, 12 valve swapped OBS question mark? That's a good question. I would like to do that. I don't want to make any promises. That's the thing. I don't want to make any promises, but I do have a possible swap project that I'm working towards obtaining, that there's a certain other YouTuber who has this truck that's currently a gas that would be converted to a diesel. But you guys, I'm not going to give out any more info than that, because I don't want to say too much if for some reason it can't happen. So yes, that is actually something we're actually in the process of trying to make happen. If it happens, you'll see what it is. If it doesn't, you won't. It is something that we are deeply considering, if it all works out. Will you ever build a 6.0? I've answered this question a lot of times. Same answer every single time. I will never build or buy something to build and give away to one of you guys that I would not trust putting myself in or my family in. If I do not have faith that that is a quality vehicle, quality motor, to be able to start up and go down the road and not have any issues, I'm not going to put one of you guys in that truck. Now, obviously, you're only going to enter for it if you want it, which is on you, but I don't want to say, hey, enter to win this truck, it's great, it's bulletproof, it's never gonna have a problem, and I really don't actually believe it, and I'm really just telling you what all the other 6.0 people would say, and then after they own the truck for a few years, and they realize it's a money pit, and so they dump it as well. If I don't trust it, I don't have faith in it, I am not going to promote it and give it away to one of you guys. Ever thought about buying another Duramax? I actually have thought about it a lot. It just seems like the Duramaxes are so freaking expensive. Like, in terms of bang for the buck, you can get like the most minty 12 valve or 24 valve with like 100,000 miles on it for like 20 grand. Like the most mint, amazing, beautiful second gen 12 valve or 24 valve. You can get one for 20 grand or less. It seems like for Duramax, at least around me, anything within 2 hours, it could have bubbles of rust, 250,000 miles, it can be an LB7, and they went freaking $25,000 for it. And I'm like, why? Like, why? Who's going to pay that for that truck? Apparently people do, because guys keep asking for it, and they keep getting it. So, I don't know, if I came across the right deal, or I just really wanted to spend a stupid amount of money on an old Duramax, just because that's what you guys would want to see, I'd consider it, but it just kind of seems like not as much bang for the buck. And I mean, obviously there's a reason people are paying a lot of money for them. People really like them, so I understand that, but it just seems like, just seems crazy to me. What is your favorite 12 valve you've ever owned? Do you ever miss the old 5-speed dually? That was his favorite truck. So in terms of my favorite 12 valve, he did say favorite 12 valve I've ever owned. My favorite 12 valve I ever owned before Nasty Red, because now I can say that I own that truck. Before that, it would have been my 5-speed 12 valve dually. That was a full build we did on the channel. A lot of fun. Absolutely love that truck. I would say now that I own Nasty Red, and I did do 90% of the work on Nasty Red myself in the shop, that was the first truck I ever did a build on, that truck would probably be my new number one favorite, just because I've got a lot of history with that truck. It's iconic. You guys clearly love the thing. Every time I make posts about it or talk about it, you guys are like, Nasty Red, Nasty Red. Like, you guys love Nasty Red. That's probably my favorite truck to drive now, because the compounds are just, they're so sweet. You can just be going down the road and just slowly bump that throttle, and then that small charger will light up that big one, and it'll just go from like slow and lugging around to where you just slowly bump that throttle, and it just spools up and will freaking launch you and have 50 PSI like that. Like, it's just so freaking fun. So I just love the drivability of that truck. Somebody asked, what is the best diesel motor in my honest opinion? My honest opinion is that the 12 valve Cummins is the most iconic, most reliable, old school diesel engine. And now here's the thing. There's a lot of new trucks out there. The new 6.7 Power Strokes, the new 6.7 Cummins, you know, the new 6.6 Duramaxes. Like they're newer, but they've been around, but they've made changes to them and stuff. You know, those could be some of the most reliable trucks out there now in terms of newer trucks. They could all be, you know, equally reliable. The only reason I say 12 valve is most reliable, hands down, is because A, they run on hardly nothing. If you have a battery, if you have 12 volts of power to start the thing and your starter's in good shape, that truck should just fire up and drive. I mean, that thing should just run, assuming your transmission's in good shape too. That's pretty important. But they can pretty much just start up and run. And even if they're running on 4 or 5 cylinders or not even running on their full 6, they'll still run and drive. Like, even if it's crappy, they will still drive and move their weight. One of those engines that it seems like you can put them in almost anything. And there's a reason people put them in almost anything, because they're super simple to fit in stuff and they're super simple to get to run and move stuff around. They're just great. I just love them. Somebody said, what tire pressure do you usually run on your trucks? What's the best for wear and ride quality? I don't know what's the best for wear. I will say that for ride quality, I'm not a tire shop here, so don't hold me responsible for this if you do this on your truck. For the most part, I wanna say we usually try to keep our tires at about 50 PSI, give or take. And I'm talking about for like Nasty Red, I'm talking about like for the Flat Nasty, Rosine. I think we run them about 50 PSI. Now, I believe, I could be wrong, but I believe a lot of the newer trucks, it's recommended you keep them closer to 80 PSI. And I could be completely wrong, so don't hold me to that. I'm pretty sure a lot of the newer stuff, like the 4th gen Reagan had, my 5th gen, those were all like, I'm pretty sure they were like either 70 or 80 PSI was the recommended tire pressure. Now, again, 50, you know, the ride quality to me, it's good. And if you have to hook up to a trailer real quick and tow with it, if it's not anything crazy, it's still plenty of PSI. Your tire's not gonna like go flat on you and like your rim's riding on the road, unless you're using super low profile tires. Maybe most of your, you know, 20 by 12 setups or your 17 by 9s like this or whatever, like if their wheel and tire setup has a pretty good amount of tire and stuff, 50 PSI is totally fine, and you might are towing with it, just ride it around town, and for the most part, it's pretty soft, pretty comfortable. I mean, it's not gonna cause you too many issues, but again, that's just my preference. You do whatever you want, your truck. Guys, hopefully you enjoyed this video. That's gonna be it for today's video. I wanted to, A, let you know that the issue with the white truck is something very simple that we have figured out, at least we know what it is. Got the bolts trimmed on the airbags here on this truck so they don't look so stupid underneath the thing. And then I told you guys on Instagram that I was gonna answer some of you guys' top questions. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. If you do wanna enter to win this beautiful 12 valve Cummins plus $5,000 cash with this fully custom leather interior, airbags, gauges, towing transmission. I mean, if you guys want to enter to win this truck, it is built to work, it's ready to work. It just needs you behind the wheel. Every $1 right now is 15 entries to win, but that deal does end on Monday. So if you do not get in by Monday, you do not get 15X entries, which by the way is a pretty freaking good deal compared to one. So if you want to get in on that, guys, thank you so much. It is going to be going back to 1X entry by Tuesday. So get in while you can, lmpgear.com, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Peace.